So, gentlemen, why don't we get started? First, I have some really good news for you all. I'm really grateful that you could come on, you know, this auspicious night. It is, after all, Wednesday, and it's great to have you here. I'm really pleased because tonight Ms. Zachter Weiser gave me some new jokes, so I don't have to keep recycling these jokes over and over again. Just wait 3 weeks and I'll tell you them again. But this is, there's actually several good jokes here. And, okay, I'll tell you one, and maybe I'll tell you the other three later in this lecture because they're really funny. So it goes like this. There's a very, very, well-respected rabbi who spends many years working for the benefit of the Jewish community where he lives, and he is well-respected and honored by his colleagues and so on, and he goes up to heaven, but it's known that he's very, very particular about all the mitzvot. He's very careful to observe all the mitzvot. So he goes up and he sees that they've prepared a beautiful smorgasbord with all kinds of appetizers and all kinds of, you know, delicious little, you know, hot dogs and, I don't know, whatever, hot dogs, whatever. But all kinds of beautiful meat like this. And so he says, this is so wonderful. I've always imagined heaven something like this. And he goes up to one of the other rabbis eating there and he says, so who's the caterer? And he says, the caterer is Masharovsky. And he says, oh, Masharovsky, very nice. Who's the mashgiach? Who's supervising the food? He says, well, this is heaven. God himself is supervising. So the rabbi says, you know, I think I'll stick with the fish. Okay, so that's, I have to work on the delivery there, but I think if I got a little chuckle, then there's potential for later. I hope you all had a chance to get the new flyer. It actually has not received complete approval yet. I hope that it's going to be okay, but it's a good draft at any rate. There are a couple of things that I'd like to draw to your attention. Ms. Abramson, would you please distribute or... with a couple things that I should draw to your attention. There's at least one typo. We're apparently giving two lectures simultaneously on March 19th.
Oh, that's good.
I'm not sure how I'm going to do that in one room, get my evil twin brother, but I think it should be March 19th and March 26th. We will correct it appropriately. Note, very importantly, we're going to be starting at 8 p.m. next week. 8 p.m. promptly. There's been a lot of people who've asked for an earlier start time, and we'll be able to do that until March 12th, when, because of the time of Mincha Maariv, it will interfere, so we're going to go back to 8:30 once the clocks have changed. The ancient period is not my personal research strength. Most of the work that I've done as a scholar, as a historian, has been in the early modern and the modern periods, basically from the 16th century onward. So now it should get better, because I know a little bit more about what I'm talking about starting next week, and hopefully it'll be interesting. I have tried very hard to include a lot of people that you probably have never heard about, but they're very influential, or at least exemplary of important parts in Jewish history. For example, we're gonna talk on January 22nd, I'm really looking forward to talking about Sarah Bas Tovim. Has anyone here who's heard of Sarah Bas Tovim? Ms. DeWeiser, you have, excellent, of course. Superior education. Sarah Bas Tovim was one of the most famous composers of women's tefillos, the so-called techinas of Eastern Europe. Beautiful prayers that were composed specifically for women and specifically addressed, you know, women's life cycle issues, women's domestic issues, and they really provide a tremendous window into an aspect of Jewish culture that has received very little scholarly attention, with the exception of the great historian Chava Weisler, who's done an amazing job of rescuing these tefillos and presenting them to the scholarly and popular world. So I'm really looking forward to speaking about her. I'm going to speak about, God willing, the Vilna Gaon, and immediately afterwards the Alter Rebbe. So, and the two of them had some significant conflict, or at least their followers had some extremely vituperative words to share with one another. So I think that will be an interesting kind of combination of the two of them. Towards the end of the period, we'll look at Heinrich Heine, who is perhaps one of the most famous Jews of the 19th century who converted to Christianity, as he put it, to get a ticket to European culture. because it's during that period of time it was very difficult to maintain one's Jewish identity and still participate in the wider society, get positions in universities, conduct orchestras, all kinds of things like this. So he is exemplary of that period. But as soon as he did it, he regretted it immediately, and he spent the rest of his poetic life. He really was one of Germany's greatest poets of the 19th century. He spent a lot of time lamenting that decision, and so it speaks to the dichotomies of the trajectories of Jewish identity in the modern period. So I think over the next few weeks, we're going to have a fantastic series of lectures, and I'm really looking forward very much to engaging in them with you. One other change that's going to happen besides the timing. This semester I experimented with not having an email list because it was a lot of work, the old Constant Contact that I used to have set up, and I didn't feel like I was getting really a lot of responses to it, so I dropped it this semester, and it was a terrible mistake because I think a lot of people really rely on just a little email nudge to remind them that there is, in fact, a class going on. So I'm going to try this coming semester to return to an email sort of reminder format with materials, videos online and things like that. So if you would like to participate in that, and I don't have your email, please send me an email to the address that's listed at the bottom of this page. That's the website. You can sign up right there, and I'll make sure that you receive the Eventbrite notices as they go out. I think that's about it for my announcements. Any other good and welfares? No, I don't think so. So let's go on. First of all, we're grateful, as always, as we come bring this particular semester. Oh, Ms. Abramson, the time. The time is 8.
No, the time's for the next semester.
You're not paying attention. Can you believe it? She's so brilliant. I said that first thing. For those of you like my daughter, we're starting at 8 p.m.
Yes.
Next week. 8 p.m. promptly.
Yes.
Okay. So, we're grateful to the Young Israel for providing this space and providing this opportunity where we can get together and discuss history and discuss some of these turning points and turning personages in our past. And we're welcoming sponsors to help support this class, this series, which the money goes to good purposes, supports these two young students who will greet you when you come in and do the filming. Mr. Rodriguez actually has an online fan club. I received a message from Germany recently. It said, "Go, Mr. Rodriguez." I'm really not sure why. Maybe it wasn't a compliment. Maybe it was like, "Go away." But it said, "Go, Mr. Rodriguez." So sponsorships are certainly welcome. We're asking for $200 per lecture so that you can defray the costs and just support the synagogue for all the good they do in this community. But I'm glad that you're all here because your presence is sponsorship more than enough and gives me the kind of energy to do this week after week, and hope that you enjoy it. Okay, so let us go directly without any further ado to our topic tonight, Nachmanides, one of the most important rabbinical minds of the High Middle Ages. He was a rabbi who originated in Spain, and towards the end of his life, when he was ready to sort of coast into a hoary old age and essentially relax in his retirement and with his students surrounding him, he was thrust into an extremely contentious debate with the church, which ultimately exiled him to Israel. But he was certainly not content to simply disappear into history, and in fact, even in his old age, he landed in Israel and completely revitalized that community in Jerusalem, which when he arrived only had, believe it or not, 2 permanent Jewish residents within the boundaries of the city. He created the first permanent minyan in Jerusalem in the medieval period, which is an amazing achievement, and essentially created the foundations for what is Israel today in many ways. So we're going to look at the arc of his life, which begins as a kind of a figure attempting to create compromise between 2 warring schools of Jewish thought, that of Spain and that of France. He moved through some fascinating periods of intellectual development and created a huge corpus of rabbinic literature that is still being mined today for the wealth of intellectual riches for contemporary scholars. And then, as I mentioned, in his final years, after being driven out of Spain as a result of this very contentious debate with the church, he really achieved his greatest things when he was living in the land of Israel. So that's basically the figure that we're going to look at today. His name, Nachmanides, like Maimonides, means son of Nachman. The ides is a Latin suffix meaning son of. And he's known to followers of his thought in Hebrew in particular as the Ramban. There's an N at the end of his name for Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman to distinguish him from Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon. It's not only the Ramban as opposed to the Rambam, the accent. If you want to be one of the cognoscenti and go to the yeshiva and prevent, you know, impress all your friends there, Rambam is pronounced with the emphasis on the first syllable, Rambam, and Ramban is pronounced with the emphasis on the second syllable, Rambam and Ramban. That's also helpful because if you can't quite make out the N or the M difference, then it helps to hear the accent. So the Ramban was born in Girona in 1194 to a very illustrious family background. He was actually a first cousin of Rabbeinu Yonah of that city, who was very important in the Maimonidean controversy. Ironically, the Ramban was intellectually a critic of Maimonides and did not hesitate to publish a series of rather blistering critiques on the Maimonidean code of Jewish law, the sacred mitzvah. But at the same time, when the crisis over Maimonidean writers in the writings in the 13th century erupted, he was a staunch defender of Maimonides against the attacks of his first cousin, Rabbeinu Yonah. The two of them were divided over that. But I'm jumping ahead of what I should do to talk about the life of the Ramban. We know that he headed up a yeshiva. We don't have a lot of information about the nature of that yeshiva, like what it looked like, how many students, what was the curriculum, and so on. But he has so many students who are reported in later rabbinic literature that there's no doubt whatsoever that this yeshiva existed. There is some evidence to indicate that he, like many rabbis of the era, earned a living outside of his rabbinic activity as a medical doctor. But unlike Maimonides, we do not have like an extensive literature of writing from the Ramban on various medical topics. But basically, he crafted as much of his early life as a rabbinic leader, as a community leader, and as a teacher of Torah. And his Torah can be understood in several different avenues of Jewish thought. And in many ways, he was very creative and actually was the originator of several key disciplines or sub-disciplines within Jewish thought. First of all, he was a halachist, meaning he spent a tremendous amount of energy, and we have multiple works in which he writes or codifies Jewish law. We should understand where he is placed within the development of Jewish law. Maybe I'll pause and step back for a second to discuss. I literally stepped back when I said that. That was kind of funny. It was funny to me anyways, Eliza. But like most of the things I say. The halakha, Jewish law, is an interesting kind of phenomenon. There's a big debate that's currently raging in Mosaic magazine, if you read the online magazine, about whether or not, whether Jewish law is primarily statutory in nature or common in nature. And I'm not a legal expert, but what I understand that to mean is that statutory laws are basically like, this is exactly how you behave and there's not much else to say about it. Whereas common law is sort of like taking a look at what people do and then developing that into legal precedents. And the two systems of law sort of communicate with each other. You'll have, you know, statements of this is how you behave, but then rabbis will say, well, we don't do it that way over here. We have a different custom. And so the statutory law will get a super commentary that says, well, that may be what the Sephardim do, but we Ashkenazim do something different. And then you'll get into a different part of the world where people will say, we don't believe actually in either of those. And so the statutory, oh, we have Rick Moore. He knows about these things, right?
A little. Yes.
So do you want to comment on Am I defining these roughly correctly?
It's difficult in a legal analysis. Statutory usually has to do with things, common laws developed in England, but it really doesn't assist right here.
Okay, good.
It does not help.
So I'm going to stipulate for the court that I know nothing about these things. Read the Mosaic magazine, you'll see where that debate is going. But in terms of the evolution of Jewish law, I can say a little bit about that with some authority, that, you know, for the majority of Jewish legal history, as we have in textual sources, we have the Mishnah, which we discussed long ago, in early October or September. The Mishnah is basically a whole bunch of statements of opinions of various rabbis with very rare examples of a decision between those opinions. You'll have a question about a given topic or behavior. Rabbi X will say one thing, Rabbi Y will say another thing, and maybe Rabbi Z will say a third thing, and if he's from Canada, you'll say Rabbi Z will say a third thing, and then they'll move on to the next topic without actually deciding. And you read the Mishnah and say, well, what kind of a law code is this? Where's the law? All I see is opinions. Then you move on to the Talmud, and the Talmud expands this tremendously with a lot of debate, again, without saying, what's the bottom line? What is the conclusion? And this debate, and engaging this debate, is considered a religious act in Judaism. The study is itself a form of prayer, a form of intellectual development, a form of, you know, self-refinement, even if you don't get to the bottom line. And in fact, many yeshivas never spend time getting to the bottom line. They spend time just following the debate. So this is fascinating, and it's all well and good in terms of intellectual exercises, but at the end of the day, someone has to say, is the chicken kosher or not? Are they allowed to marry or not? What's the decision? So at some point, this Talmudic debate is transformed into a halakha, which means the way, which is transformed into some kind of statutory law. This is the law, they can marry, the chicken is not kosher, that kind of thing. The way that these codes of laws were formed, right, the transference from the debate of the Talmud into a list of rules is something that took several hundred years to compile. And it began really in North Africa and in Spain about 100 years before the Ramban. And at that time, there were, in particular, the Alfasi, or the Rif as he's known. What he did was he essentially took the Talmud and he edited out all of the debate as much as possible that did not deal direct with halacha, and he left you with a much smaller version of the Talmud, which was designed to sort of refine your reading of it towards the law. He did not state the bottom line, this is the law, but he said, okay, just ignore all that other stuff and concentrate on the law. Ironically, this would be repeated in reverse by another scholar, Yosef ibn Chabib, who wrote the Ein Yaakov, in which he said, you know what, the Talmudic law is very interesting, but I love all that other stuff that you ignored. And so he created a separate Talmud called the Ein Yaakov, which is all the legendary material, the philosophical material, the recipes, the biographies, all that stuff was in a separate book. Very fascinating reading. So this is not actually a law code yet. And it took figures like Maimonides to say, all right, let's sort this all out and let's organize it by topics rather than by discussions. And we'll, you know, break everything up and we'll have no problem taking laws which are mentioned in one part of the Talmud and we'll gather it with something discussed in another part of the Talmud and create a logical code. The most famous of them was his Mishnah Torah, his repetition of Torah, as we discussed in this class several weeks ago. When he came out with this code, and there were a few contemporaries who were also coming out with similar things on a much smaller scale, naturally there was a tremendous amount of debate, because all of a sudden, all of this discussion that was open-ended, that people could engage in, it was kind of like open source code for software, all of a sudden it was being kind of like hammered into one particular form. It was like Microsoft or Apple. Linux was not on the scene then. People couldn't just go in and muck around with the code they wanted to. And so there's a tremendous amount of debate. And in this area, there were two major schools of thought about what to do with this process. Spain loved the direction that Maimonides had taken the formation of legal codes, and they spent a tremendous amount of time reinforcing them and adhering to them, because Spain was very, you know, orthopractic, very interested in saying what is the law, moving towards the law, even if it meant spending less time in the Talmud and more time in the codes. In France, on the other hand, they were very upset with this, and they felt that, you know, you're ignoring the sources of the Talmud, and people, if they just go to the laws, they'll never know how we got there. They'll never, you know, experience the thrill of debate. They'll never experience the mental purification process that goes through the back and forth. And so the schools in France were very upset about Maimonides. And in fact, as we discussed earlier, in 1232, they succeeded in having the church burn Maimonides' works. That's how extreme the tension was between the French and the Spanish scholars. So what Nachmanides, or the Ramban, represents is he had a broad enough intellect that he could see the value of both schools. And he attempted, with moderate success, to create a synthesis that engages in the study of Talmud for its own sake, but at the same time tries to arrive at a conclusion in the end. This school was ultimately developed much further by the Tosafists, who also realized that the pure study of the Talmud was of great value, but at the end of the day, we really have to understand how to behave, and so they also drove some of their argument, not quite as much as Nachmanides, towards a final conclusion. This is the kind of work that Nachmanides did, primarily within the halakhic realm, and truth be told, this sort of combination of theory and practice formed the foundation of the next 800 years of Talmudic and legal study in Judaism. So he's an extremely influential thinker in bringing together these two very different approaches to Torah. Yes,
Dan? Did he write a book? How does this manifest itself?
Oh, excellent. Well, he wrote actually several books. Right. His collected works today are published, well, they were, you know, it wasn't until the 20th century that all of them were actually published. Many of them remained in incunabula or in manuscript version to the 20th century, but the critical edition that circulates today is four very thick double column volumes on a whole host of topics. In this particular area, he was mainly writing commentaries on Talmud and standalone works that dealt with specific subjects. For example, wrote a fantastic book on death called Torah Ta'adam, which deals with the practical and the philosophical implications of death in Judaism. Very, very profound ideas. He wrote quite a bit of Kabbalistic commentaries scattered throughout his works, but only one actual solely standalone work of Kabbalah. And he wrote significant commentaries following the Talmudic tractates. So all of these things contribute towards his reputation as an original thinker. But the most famous, without doubt, if you have heard of the Ramban, probably 9 times out of 10 you've heard of him because of his brilliant commentary on the Torah, which occupies, in that four-volume set that I mentioned earlier, it's two full volumes of these dense little, you know, double-column pages with little footnotes at the bottom. And certainly, his commentary earns pride of place only behind Rashi himself. Of all the commentaries that we preserve of the Torah, it's certainly Ramban. And in fact, that's, with the exception perhaps of the Aramaic translation of Unculus, which is studied for other reasons, if one masters Rashi, the next logical step is Ramban. It has been very ably translated into English a couple of times, and there's a fairly new edition that I have a feeling Rick Moore is going to get out of the library right now that has met with tremendous popular appeal, and I highly recommend it to you. The difference, the major creative difference of Nachmanides' commentary in the Torah is so obvious to us now that when I tell you, you'll kind of be saying, like, you know, vos epis, I'm here to hear this is obvious, but in fact it was not obvious at the time. Rashi's commentary, the main purpose of Rashi's commentary is to bring together the written Torah with the oral Torah. In other words, here we are reading the written Torah, and there are a lot of opaque passages and a lot of difficult passages, and we have, oh, thank you very much.
These are just two of four, I think.
Thank you, my lovely assistant, Rick Moore. Let's have, thanks, Sam. Okay. This is the new translation published by Art Scroll. The translator is, I should see who translated it, Rabbi Yaakov Blinder, or Blinder. I'm not sure how to, it's either Blinder or Blinder. I apologize, Rabbi. But this is a very well-received translation, and you can see it's got the Hebrew original and the Aramaic translation of Onkelos. It's got Rashi's commentary, which is often very relevant to the commentary of the Ramban himself, because the Ramban will often polemicize with Rashi. He'll often take issue with Rashi. But to discuss what is the point of the Ramban's commentary, Rashi's main point is he wants to show the unity of the written Torah and the oral Torah, because that's a very basic idea of Judaism, that, you know, we have these two Torahs, which are rather different in meaning, and Rashi brilliantly and concisely anthologizes the oral Torah and provides it as a running commentary to the written Torah. So you really get with Rashi sort of like the distilled wine of both of these Torahs. The Ramban isn't trying to do that at all. Rashi has achieved that, and here it is, you know, 100-odd years later, and the Ramban says, well, let's ask some deeper questions. Let's synthesize this. Let us challenge the meaning of this. You know, like he will, for example, it's almost a taboo topic today. Some very big rabbis have gotten into a lot of trouble for psychologically analyzing great biblical figures. You know, and he will, on occasion, take them to task. You know, he'll say that, you know, our forefather Abraham, for example, erred when he tried to pass Sarah off as his sister rather than his wife, which is a rather courageous thing to say. I would be scared to say it, except I'm quoting Ramban. I can get away with it in our society today. So he really is much more of a, we would consider him a modern commentator, because he's not just trying to hold our hand through the text. He's having essentially small essays on major themes in the Torah. So it's a brilliant, fascinating commentary, which takes us into a much deeper philosophical analysis of the text than Rashi did. Rashi is essentially just trying to marry the written Torah to the oral Torah, so we get a holistic approach to it. The Ramban will say, I don't understand why this is so. And he'll opine various, you know, approaches to the text, and really provides a much more engaging and fascinating approach to it. His style is quite different from Rashi or from commentaries of his era, whereas Rashi's comments are famous for their brevity. You know, that they say in yeshiva, they used to say, beware of a long Rashi or a short Tosfos, right? Because if Rashi spends a long time explaining something, it means it's a lot of difficulty. And Tosfos, on the other hand, is normally verbose, so if Tosfos is short, it's going to be a real hard nut to crack. The Ramban tends to be like Tosfos in the sense of being, you know, takes up much more space, much more loquacious, not to the point of tedium, God forbid, but he will, you know, really discuss an idea to its fullest, whereas Rashi will only offer little, you know, hints and nuggets at deeper psychological and philosophical interests. Yes, Dan.
Was this commentary written in Spanish or?
No, Hebrew. Absolutely, rabbinic Hebrew. On a couple of occasions, the Ramban wrote in Aramaic, and well, I'm not gonna discuss those. It's kind of interesting, but. There's also quite a bit of Kabbalistic references scattered throughout the text, which this is just around the time when Kabbalah is beginning to sort of emerge as a dominant trend, it's particularly in Spanish Jewish thought. And although the Ramban wrote very little that was explicitly dedicated to Kabbalah, there is no question that it influenced quite a bit of his writing. There are all kinds of passages here and there that are sort of mystical and opaque, and analysis of the Ramban's writings in Kabbalah really created a major engine of interest and activity for medieval Jews. Okay, as I mentioned a little earlier, he got caught up in the Maimonidean controversy, which was not only over Maimonides' attempt to codify the law in the Mishneh Torah, it was also based in Maimonides' rationalist approach. Maimonides was the uber-rationalist of Jewish history, and even Nachmanides had difficulty with it at many times. Like, for example, when the what passage was it? I think it was when the angels appeared to Abraham. Oh, I've forgotten what passage it was.
The donkey, perhaps? The donkey speaking?
The talking donkey, yes. That's one of the more difficult passages. I don't recall what the Ramban Maimonides writes on that, but one passage I remember offhand, but I don't think this is one that Nachmanides responded to. If you've read the book of Samuel 1, Shmuel Aleph, chapter 28, there's a very difficult passage where Shaul, the king, worried about his fate in the war with the Philistines. There was going to be a big battle the next day. He went to the witch of Endor. And he had already banished the witches from Israel, but apparently this was one witch who had, you know, escaped by being under the radar. And it's very clear when you read the text, it's straightforward. He convinces the witch to bring back the prophet Samuel from the dead, kind of like a seance. And then, you know, Samuel comes back. It's actually got a kind of a funny aspect to it. Saul says to him, you know, "Oh, Samuel." And Samuel says, "Why are you bothering me to come all the way back from the land of the dead? Tomorrow you can talk to me in person." Meaning you're going to die. So majority of biblical commentators take it at face value that, yeah, there's this witch and she has this power of bringing back the dead. There's a whole complication. You can see, but you can't hear. You can hear, you can't see. But the Ramban, the Maimonides says, not at all. It was smoke and mirrors. This was a charade that was designed. She took advantage of Shaul's, you know, distraught mental state, and this is just the way she made her living. There's no such thing as bringing people back from the dead to talk and things like that. But the majority of commentators disagree with Maimonides, and they feel he's being excessively rationalist. So one of the major critiques of Maimonides is that he was overly influenced by Aristotelian philosophy. And even though Nachmanides was a Kabbalist, and the mystics tend to be quite divorced from the rationalists, even though he himself was a Kabbalist, he felt constrained to defend Maimonides and his way of thinking. Nevertheless, his attempt to find a compromise between the rationalists and the Kabbalists was unsuccessful. He was able to bring about an intellectual compromise between France and Spain, perhaps in the way we study Talmud, but he could not diffuse the debate over Maimonides, and sadly, the latter's works were destroyed in fire in the Louvre. Now, so moving on towards one of the more dramatic periods in Nachmanides' life is the disputation of 1263. Was it only last week we talked about Nicholas Donin, Mr.
Yes.
Rodriguez? It was last week, right? So one of the 13th century was overall not a good time for Jews in Europe. It was a period when the church was ascendant, temporal powers were losing their authority, and in general, during this kind of triumphalist ecclesiastical period, Jews fared poorly. As the church attempted to highly regulate their behavior and to segregate them to certain segments of society. It's not that the kings were great friends of the Jews, but one of the things that kept the Jews in the good favor of the kings and had the kings really defend them was something that, now, I don't know if I've ever mentioned it in this class. It's the Abramson rule of history?
I don't know.
No? How about Ms. Abramson? What is the Abramson rule of history, Ms. Abramson?
Money.
Money, absolutely. Thank you so much. That's the one takeaway message I hope my undergraduates get. It's amazing how long I repeat it over and over again. Maybe it's something about being 20 that you just can't think about those things. But at any rate, The Jews occupied a very interesting niche in the economic system of High Middle Ages Europe. It was a corporate structure or a feudal structure in which the Jews had a status called servi kamarai, which means the servants of the royal chamber. And just in a nutshell, you know, maybe in another lecture we'll expand on this, but basically, the Jews were, Jews occupied a certain status in the economic structure of what was basically a barter society, where they were one of the few groups that actually dealt in precious metals, in coinage. And this was through petty money lending, it was through small-time commerce, sometimes larger commerce. And so that meant that they generated a lot of cash money, as opposed to chickens and, you know, pillowcases and fields of wheat. They actually had ready cash, much more than most elements of society, because of that particular niche. So what the kings did in medieval Europe is they said that the Jews will be taxed directly by the royal chamber. That's what that servi camerae means, is that they are servants of the royal chamber directly. So you could have, you know, like Shloimi and Yitzchak and Rivka and Sprinza and Seitel, who are living in a little shtetl, and they're living in a shack, essentially, but they are actually direct subjects of the king. They are not subjects of the local duke or the baron or the lord. They actually report directly to the king. Not that they would ever see the king, but their money would. So the Jews, on the one hand, you know, did not necessarily have a very high lifestyle, but the fact that they lived in urban areas and worked in industries that generated cash meant that they could generate also a lot of tax revenue for the king. And the king, in return for that tax revenue, protected the Jews. Hence the phrase, the king's Jews, which you may have heard of, which is kind of funny. We have at the college, we have an excellent librarian, really one of the best librarians ever work with. She's Cuban and not Jewish, and all her friends ask, you know, how are your Jews doing? You know, all of us at the college are her Jews. So, you know, I find that amusing, but at any rate, let's tell another joke. That one, here we go. So, here we go. There's this old rabbi is walking out of shul one day, and a gust of wind comes and blows his hat off his head and across a busy street. So the elderly rabbi, he can't quite cross the street, but across the street there's a young man who sees this happening, and so he goes out and he gets the hat and he returns it to the rabbi and he gives it to him. The rabbi says, bless you, my son. So this guy, he says, wow, I've been blessed by the rabbi, it must be my lucky day. So what he does is he goes to the racetrack and he's looking at the names of the horses, and he sees there's a hat named Cap. So he says, Cap, you know, maybe that's a sign. I rescued the rabbi's hat, I'm gonna bid on Cap. And sure enough, Cap comes in first. He makes a lot of money. And he says, wow, this is great. He looks at the next race and he sees there is another horse whose name is Top Hat. Top Hat, wow, this is great. Puts all the money on Top Hat. Top Hat comes in first. And it goes on and on all day with all these kinds of hat metaphors. Finally, he comes home at the end of the day, and he's all depressed, and his wife says, what happened? And he tells her the whole story, and she says, well, what happened? I mean, where's the money? He says, well, you know, at the very last race, I bid on a horse called Chateau. And she said, you idiot. You're thinking of chapeau in French. Chapeau is hat. He says, oh, it doesn't matter. It was some Japanese horse called Yamaka that won in the end. Thank you, Mr. Weiser. That's good. Okay, that's it. I only have like three jokes left now. That's a year. But, okay. Anyways, so... before the joke. Servi Camerae, right. So you've got this period in the 13th century. The church is ascendant. The church is not benefiting from these tax resources. And so as they get more powerful, various reasons that are beyond our scope here, they pressure the kings. And they say, what are you doing allowing the Jews to prosper like this? I mean, we know what you're doing. You're getting tax revenue, but this is not right. You have to keep them down lower. They have to have a subservient state, because how does it look that those who, you know, who reject Jesus, that they should be in such a high level in our society? How appropriate on Wednesday we should be discussing this. So what happens is, as the kings lose kind of power and traction vis-a-vis the church, the Jews tend to do poorly. This is a phenomenon that stretches through much of the 13th century in particular. And one of the expressions of this was the so-called disputation, where churchmen, for various reasons, we saw Nicholas Donan last week, would sponsor a forced debate between representatives of Judaism and representatives of the church. And these debates would often be held in churches with an audience of dignitaries and nobles, and the Jews would be expected to, you know, put forth an argument for Judaism, which would then be thoroughly trounced by their Christian interlocutors, and then everyone would go home at the end of the day saying, well, this is great, we have this amazing religion, those Jews are so obstinate, look, how can they keep believing this stuff? That was the way the thing was supposed to go. Typically, the debater on the Christian side would be a convert from Judaism to Christianity, who had some knowledge of Jewish texts and so on and so forth. So, in the case of Nachmanides, it was a man who took the name Pablo Cristiani. To his dismay, however, when they called for this disputation, they demanded the leader of the Jewish community to represent Judaism, and it was none other than Nachmanides, who was really the kind of mind that only comes along once every 1,000 years, debating against some schlemazel, and it was a rout. It was a terrible rout, and it was extremely embarrassing for the church. When he was invited to this disputation, Ms. Abramson, a brilliant question.
How was Ramban even allowed to go into the church, though?
Excellent question. What my brilliant daughter is alluding to is a halakha that is. I'm not paskening halakha, especially not in the shul where we, you know, the rav is the posek, but there is a large body of traditional religious thought that argues that Jews are not allowed to go into a church or into a mosque, although there's a lot to say about both of those. The main idea behind that, in my humble opinion, is what's called marit ayin, meaning what will people think? It's the seeing of the eye. It's not appropriate for a Jew like me, let's say, for example, dressed like this, wearing a tie, to walk into a church. That's a joke. I meant this here, too. You know, because then people say, oh, look at that. What's going on with Hillel Abramson? He's going to a church. So marit ayin does not apply when people know why you're going into a church. You're not going in for the purpose of worship. So, like, let's say, for example, as happens sometimes, because churches are large open public spaces, they're sometimes purchased by synagogues or by yeshivas. So, you know, the rabbis are allowed to go in and check out the space to see if it's, you know, if it has a big for sale sign out front, no one's thinking it's Maridai. So in this case, I would humbly tender that he's certainly allowed to go in because everybody knows he's forced to go in there to participate in this debate. Very subtle question, isn't that amazing? And she's going to Israel, God willing, next September, where she will become even greater and become a leader of the Jewish people.
Thank God.
Okay, God willing. Okay, so anyways, Nachmanides, before he participated, he insisted successfully that he said, okay, if you want me to participate in this debate, one basic rule, I have to be allowed to say whatever I want. You know, you can't, like, make me go into this debate and tie my hands behind my back. I have to be able to muster any argument you ask for. So the church agreed to this, and in the summer of 1263, they had four dates for the debate in that summer, and Nachmanides came out with just absolutely destroying his opponent. The results were interesting. We do have two accounts of the debate. We have the Christian account written in Latin by Pablo de Cristiani, in which, of course, as you probably figured out by now, the church wins, because how can you sponsor a debate like this for the whole point of diminishing Judaism and have the church do poorly? So the church, the judges, who are all clergymen, decide, yes, Christianity wins. But we also have Maimonides' account, which has become a classic of medieval literature. It's called the Sefer HaVikuach, the Book of the Debate, which is about 25 pages long in Hebrew, and it's published in the collected editions. You know, reading the Christian side, it looks like the Christians win. Reading the Jewish side, it looks like Nachmanides wins. But when you look at a few other, you know, external factors, it seems pretty clear that Nachmanides was the winner. First of all, the church ended the debate early. Said it's too much already, enough. And even though they pronounced the church the winner, Pablo de Cristiani the winner, the king gave Nachmanides the bonus money of 300 gold coins. Normally you give the bonus money to the winner, but the king obviously enjoyed himself thoroughly. And Nachmanides was then invited to visit the palace to meet privately with the king. We don't know exactly what the content of their conversations were, but obviously the king was well taken with Nachmanides. And if that wasn't enough, the church demanded that they banish Nachmanides forever, because he's just dynamite. You can't have this guy around. It makes us look bad. And unfortunately, that's ultimately what happened. Reading the accounts of the debate is quite fascinating, but I'm not going to go into that right now. The Demanicans wanted Nachmanides to stand trial for blasphemy. And you'll recall that he had said, listen, if you want me to really participate in this, you got to let me say whatever I want. And in fact, he did speak his mind. So when they threatened to place him on trial, it seemed that the only way that that he could survive this is if he accepted to be banished. The Dominicans went over the head of the king. They went to the Pope to try and get the Pope to support them, and that's when Nachmanides realized that he was lost, and he fled Spain for Eretz Israel. He was already, at this point, I believe, in his mid-70s. So he's really towards the end of his academic, intellectual, rabbinic career, and yet it is this point that in many ways he achieved his greatest successes. Just one point about the debate, though, that really should be discussed. Nachmanides employed an extremely subtle and brilliant and elegantly simple technique to defuse one of the strongest attacks on the Talmud. And you recall from Nicholas Donan, the discussion last week, that, you know, if this ended badly, that, you know, tens of thousands of precious manuscripts could be destroyed if Nachmanides doesn't hold his own. So one of the biggest charges, and Pablo de Cristiani was actually much better prepared than Nicholas Donan, was that the Talmud blasphemes Jesus, and specifically says some terrible things about Jesus' personage, about his parentage, about his character, all kinds of things that, according to the internal rules of this debate, were unforgivable sins. And Nachmanides' defense was very simple. He said, that Jesus? Oh no, that's not the Jesus that you guys worship. That's another guy named Jesus. And he consistently maintained that, you know, it's not an uncommon name, Yoshua, right? Joshua. He consistently maintained that, because we do have a character named Yoshua that had a rabbi named Rabbi Yoshua ben Prachya. His teacher was also named Yeshua ben Prachya. And the timing doesn't work. The Jesus of the Talmud could easily be an entirely different person. It's unlikely. Chances are, when the Talmud says negative things about Jesus, they mean the Christian Jesus. Once again, since it's Wednesday, it's totally appropriate for us to be discussing this. But Nachmanides, whenever Pablo de Cristiani came out with a criticism, said, look at what it says over here about Jesus. He says, that's a totally different Jesus. That's not talking about your Jesus at all. And so de Cristiani was defenseless against that argument, because it could not be said to be blasphemous if it wasn't speaking about the same person at all. And so a Yiddish cup, absolutely. He completely deflected the worst criticisms, and the debate had to, you know, ground to a halt whenever de Cristiani really thought he had the best arguments to marshal against the Talmud. At this time, most likely, he wrote the Igeret HaRamban, a very, very beautiful and moving letter, which, you know, is worth actually quoting a little bit. I wonder if we have it in a prayer book. It's very powerful passage. Now, Aliza, didn't we study this when we were... I studied with my eldest daughter, Rafaela, before her bat mitzvah. We studied in depth the Ramban for this particular letter for about 6 weeks. Ah, here it is, page 994. If you all just open up your prayer books to page 994, please rise. thought that was funny. No, not funny. Okay, where is it here? So let me read it to you, because it is really, it's a beautiful piece of rabbinic writing. He wrote this to his family when he was forced to leave Spain, and it's essentially a letter to his son about how he wants him to behave for the rest of his life. It's part of a long tradition of what's called the tzava in Jewish literature, or the will, the ethical will. It's a document written not saying who gets my stocks and who gets the cars and who gets the house. It's a document that says, you know, this is how I want you to lead your life. As it happens, my wife and I have a custom that we write one of these every year before Yom Kippur and give it to each of our children individually, because, you know, you never know what could happen in that year. All right, let me read a little bit of this to you, okay? I'll read it to you in English. Heed, my son, the discipline of your father, and do not forsake the guidance of your mother. Accustom yourself to speak gently to all people at all times. This will protect you from anger, a most serious character flaw which causes one to sin. Our rabbis taught, whoever flares up in anger is subject to the discipline of Gehenna, hell. As it is written, banish anger from your heart and remove evil from your flesh. The evil mentioned here refers to Gehenna, as it is written, and the wicked are destined for the day of evil. Once you have distanced yourself from anger, the quality of humility will enter your hearts. This sterling quality is the finest of all admirable traits, as Scripture writes, on the heels of humility comes the fear of Hashem. Through humility, the fear of God will intensify in your heart, for you will always be aware from where you have come and to where you are destined to go. You will realize that in life you are as frail as the maggot or the worm, all the more so in death. It is this sense of humility which reminds you of the one before whom you will be called for judgment, the King of Glory. Of him it is written, behold, heaven and the heaven of heavens cannot contain you, surely not the hearts of men. Furthermore, it is written, do I not fill heaven and earth, says Hashem? After you give serious thought to these ideas, you will stand in awe of your Creator and will be guarded against sin. Once you have acquired these fine qualities, you will indeed be happy with your lot. When your actions display genuine humility, when you stand meekly before man and fearfully before God, when you stand wary of sin, then the Spirit of God's presence will rest upon you, as will the splendor of His glory. You will live the life of the world to come. And now, my son, understand clearly that one who is prideful in his heart toward other men rebels against the sovereignty of Hashem, for he glorifies himself in God's own robes, for it is written, Hashem reigns, he dons the mantle of grandeur. For indeed, of what should man be prideful? If he has wealth, it is Hashem who makes one poor or prosperous. And if honor, does honor not belong to God? As it is written, wealth and honor come from you. How can one glorify himself with the honor of his maker? If he takes pride in wisdom, let him understand that God may remove the speech of the most competent and take away the wisdom of the aged. Thus all men stand as equals before the Creator. In his fury he casts down the lofty, in his goodwill he elevates the downtrodden. Therefore humble yourself, for Hashem will lift you up. Thus I shall explain to you how you may accustom yourself to the quality of humility, to walk with it always. Let your words be spoken gently, let your head be bowed. Cast your eyes downward and your heart heavenward. And when speaking, do not stare at your listener. Let all men seem greater than you in your eyes. If another is wiser or wealthier than yourself, you must show him respect. And if he is poor and you are richer or wiser than he, consider that he may be more righteous than yourself. If he sins, it is the result of error, while your transgression is deliberate. In all your words, actions, and thoughts, at all times, imagine in your heart that you are standing in the presence of the Holy One, blessed be He, and that His presence rests upon you. Indeed, the glory of Hashem fills the universe. Speak with reverence and awe, like a servant who stands in the presence of his master. Act with restraint in the company of others. If one should call out to you, do not answer with a loud voice, but respond gently, in low tones, as one who stands before his mentor. Take care to always study Torah diligently so that you'll be able to fulfill its commands. When you rise from study, ponder carefully what you have learned. See what there is in it which you can put into practice. Review your actions every morning and evening, and in this way live all your days in repentance. Cast external matters from your mind when you stand to pray. Carefully prepare your heart in the presence of the Holy One. Purify your thoughts and ponder your words before you utter them. Almost done. Conduct yourself in these ways in all your endeavors for as long as you may live. In this way you will surely avoid transgression. Your words, actions, and thoughts will be flawless. Your prayer will be pure and clear, sincere and pleasing to God. Blessed is he, as is written, when you prepare their heart to concentrate, you are attentive to their prayers. Read this letter once a week, he concludes, and neglect none of this. Fulfill it, and in so doing, walk with it forever in the ways of Hashem, may you be blessed, so that you may succeed in your ways and merit the world to come that lies hidden for the righteous. Every day that you shall read this letter, Hashem shall answer your heart's desires. Amen, Selah. So that's why it's printed in the prayer book, is because many people do have the custom of reading it every single day. Others have the custom of reading it every week. Others have the custom of reading it whenever they give a lecture on Nachmanides. But it's a beautiful, you know, exhortation for ethical behavior, and I think you get a sense of his personality coming through. That even though he's a man who was the leader of his community, very well published, a man capable of aggressive debate, not fearful of power, and enduring great, you know, punishment, nevertheless, the letter is all about being humble.
What was the name of his son?
I don't know. I think his last name was Ides. But that's about all I know. That was a joke. Nachmanides. Okay, we'll take that out of the internet part. Let's go on. He arrived in Israel in the year 1267. He found very few Jews in Jerusalem. And in fact, he writes that there are only two permanent residents in the holy city, two permanent Jewish residents, that when they wanted to make a minyan for Shabbos, they actually had to bring in Jews living in the surrounding countryside. Israel at that time had been devastated by the roving Tatar hordes that had made their way into it. And Nachmanides, as an older gentleman, came to this devastated Jewish community, and rather than simply giving up and saying, oy vey is mir, he started to build. The very first thing is, he established a synagogue, and he made sure that there was a permanent minyan in Jerusalem again. He got the building himself, and it still is in place today in Jerusalem. His legacy is, and of course, around Nachmanides, around this great scholar, if you can imagine, Lahavdil, this is the Einstein of Torah. You know, even that is a very vague kind of comparison. This is one of the greatest minds coming to this, even though it's Jerusalem, it was a rural backwater of Judaism, and just by the force of his personality and his intellect, creating a community around it and planting the seeds for a much larger community to come. So when we think about the legacy of Nachmanides, we can reflect on the tremendous literary achievements, his great work as a synthesizer of the Spanish and French approaches to Torah, his incredibly powerful and enduring Torah commentary, and towards the end of his life, the brilliant way he handled the disputation, followed by the reconstruction, his greatest achievement, of the Jewish community in Jerusalem. So with that, I'm going to formally conclude, and I thank you very much for your attention. Please recall, next week we'll be at 8 p.m. sharp. Thank you once again.